I said, can I get a witness? Oh, sorry. All right, there we go. It's good to have right here today, Nate and Brooke Ward. They're here. They've moved to Richland. And because they love Jesus so much, they're going to drive from Richland every Sunday to be at church with us, I'm sure. No. We're glad to have you guys here. And can we just extend our hands toward this couple? You know, Lord Jesus, I know you're going to be back and visit us from time to time. We sure hope so. But Lord, we just want to just bless Nate and Brooke and their kids, Jesus, and this new venture over there in Richland. I just pray your hand to be upon them, the favor of God to be upon them, and they would find a really good fellowship there in that area that they could plug into. Bless them. Good to have you guys here. Amen. Awesome to have you here. I heard about this pastor. He was trying to raise money for a new sanctuary. He told his congregation one Sunday, he said, if anyone will give $1,000, that person may pick out the next three hymns. A little old lady in the back raised her hand. Pastor, I'll do it. He was so excited, and he said, thank you so much. Go ahead and pick out our next three hymns. She looked over the congregation and said, I'll take him and him and him. Now, those three might have been a little anxious when they saw they were being pointed out. Speaking of anxiety, do any of you ever get test anxiety? All right, you freeze up, you know, you've done your homework, you've studied hard, and you're sure you have the answers. You go in the next day, and man, you just can't put it together. If that sounds like you, you probably have a case of test anxiety. You know, that nervous feeling that people sometimes get when they're about to take a test. Some try to get a little edge. That reminds me, a professor was giving a big test one day to his students. He handed out all the tests and went back to his desk to wait. Once the test was over, the students all handed the tests back in. The professor noticed that one of the students had attached a $100 bill to his test, and with a note that said $1 per point. The next class, the professor handed the graded test back out. The student got back the test and $64 change. I don't think he passed that test. As a rule, I have never really struggled with test anxiety. I figure I either know the material or I don't. And if I, you know, and normally I would study, I have a pretty good handle on it. I really wasn't nervous very often. And it's good to be relaxed when you take tests, especially if you are prepared. Relaxing when you're not prepared isn't such a good idea. Back when I was at Cal Baptist College, now Cal Baptist University, thank you very much, I took a math class, actually. I had to take one to graduate. And so I took a bonehead math class, you know, 101 or whatever it was. And I think it was my sophomore or junior year. And so I showed up to class, and attendance was not required. But I went to class every day for the first 2 or 3 weeks, however it was, took the first test. I aced it. It was so easy. I thought, man, I've learned all this in high school. This is a piece of cake. And then I looked through the syllabus. I noticed that all the basic subject that would be covered, I go, I'm sure I know all that, no problem. So here's what I'll do. They don't take attendance. I'll just show up and take the test. I took the next test 2 or 3 weeks later. I thought, man, that was the easiest test. Tilton, I thought, you're a genius. You don't need no education. That's what I thought. I took a few more of those easy tests. Never bothered to check my scores. I was sure that I had an easy A, automatic A. Well, one day I happened to be going down the hallway in front of the math class, and I noticed that the other fools in the class were nervously checking their scores until I looked to see, and I let them all go until I would look and see the obvious A pluses that would be by my name. But little did I know, little did I know, I got a big old F. That's what I was getting. Now, sure, I didn't put any time in it. Sure, I didn't study. Sure, I didn't go to class, but I was so mad at the teacher. How dare she flunk me? I came back to class for the last few weeks, just got my grade up to a D. Now, had I been smart and shown up to class and done the very simple but daily required work that math has to have, I would have got an A easily. It was a relatively easy course. But I was shocked to end up with an F. I've never seen one by my name before. I was stunned. Imagine the shock many will sense when they receive their final grade from the judge regarding their time on earth. We've been going through the book of 2 Corinthians for the past 2.5-3 months, and we've covered a lot of topics. I think it's a fascinating book. I've just really enjoyed teaching through it. We've talked about comfort in suffering and turning to Christ, and when you turn to Christ, the veil is removed. We talked about that heaven is there and there's rewards coming. We talked about don't be unequally yoked, that you are in fact the very temple of God himself. We talked about strongholds and how to break them. We talked about that everybody has a sphere of influence. We talked about the blessing of being a giver. And this morning we're going to finish up the series in 2 Corinthians with this particular verse found in 2 Corinthians 13:5, as Paul, in a sense, kind of caps the book. Actually, 2 Corinthians is kind of probably two books. The first 9 chapters were one book and the last 3 were another one, but it doesn't matter. Here's how he puts it in 2 Corinthians 13:5. He says this: examine yourselves. Now he's talking to a church people. He's talking to Christians. Examine yourselves to see whether you are in the faith. Test yourselves. Or don't you realize this about yourselves, that Jesus Christ is in you, unless indeed you fail to meet the test. Paul is inviting us to think. That's really what he's doing. And to think critically about who we are and where we're going. Isaiah said, you know, come let us reason together. I like this quote from a pastor. He says, seldom do we think about how seldom we think. Seldom do we think about how seldom we think. Taking a good long look at ourselves can really, a good long honest look at ourselves can really bring about positive changes in our lives. I have a friend, his name is Brooke. We were roughly, and we knew each other back in the high school days about, 4 or 5 years ago. Not a zero in the end, probably, really. It was getting close. But we were friends, and we hung out in a Christian group, and we would, go to Bible studies together and with a larger group, of course, and minister together. He was always a very happy person, it seemed, and very much on fire, it seemed, for the Lord. And and so through the years, I sort of lost touch with him, but I'd hear little reports every once in a while, and I would hear through the years that, oh, man, have you heard about old Brooke? And, what's going on? Well, he's been in and out of jail. Oh, really? And he's really just turned to alcohol in a big way, and I think he's doing drugs, and he's become a thief. And so I'd heard these things. And then I'd heard that he'd become homeless, and he had a pretty reasonably decent job for a while, and then because he was in and out of jail and he was hooked on those things, he was homeless for many years, actually. And imagine how stunned I was then to get a phone call from him about 3 or 4 years ago, it was probably. And I don't know how he got my number, but he did somehow, and he called and he said, hey, I'm in town. Can you meet me at my folks' place in Kalama? I'd like to see you. And I said, absolutely. Are you kidding? Of course I'd love to see you. I showed up and I saw him, and he looked good. He looked good. He had the old, face there, and he seemed pretty happy, and we were talking, and I said, so Brooke, what's been happening these last 30 years plus? And he went on to say that, well, not long after he was out of high school, a lot of the hurts and the wounds that were deep within him started to bubble out. Things that he'd never really dealt with, and a lot of his anger and hurts and bitterness and pain and wounding. And then he, rather than turn really more towards the Lord, he turned away from the Lord, and he started to, you know, try to medicate his pain other ways. And anyway, and then he ended up, he told a story about, he lived in sort of a tent community with a bunch of other homeless people and became a thief and a drunk. He was drinking and stealing at least a fifth every day, and he was doing drugs and whatever else he was doing. And then he said he was homeless for 7 years, and he just, you know, was really down in the dumps. Of course, it was San Diego, so it could be a worse place to be homeless, but he was down there. And then he said, but now I've got a great job. I work for a hotel chain. I'm in management. And I said, so how do you do that? How do you go from being an on-fire Christian, seemingly anyway, to somebody who walks away, gets into all that other stuff, and then homeless, and then to now have a responsible, good position in your life? He said, I'll tell you when it was that changed my life. He said, I was in San Diego, and I was using one of the community bathrooms there, and you know how those are. They all have mirrors that are really hard to see in, or they're cracked or whatever. But he went in there, and he's looking in the mirror, you know, and he kind of just really starts to stare at himself. Really, he said, for the first time, he began to look at himself in the mirror. And he stared for the longest time, and he goes, what am I doing? And he basically spoke to himself, Brooke, this isn't you. This doesn't have to be this way. It's time for a change. Amazingly, he never touched another drop. He got out of homelessness. He applied himself and eventually found a really good job. He's doing well in life. But it took a serious examination of himself. I like this quote from Israel Moore. Iavor is his name. And it's a good one, I think. He says, the only way to make a spoilt machine work again is to break it down, work on its inner system, and fix it again. Screw out the bolts of your life, examine and work on yourself, fix your life, and get going. The question we're asking this morning, are you examining yourself? Are you ready to pass the exam? Are you passing the test? Really, what we're really asking, and what Paul is really asking, is, are you genuinely a Christian? Are you really sure you are right with the Lord? Many people who claim to be a Christian at one point will look back and say, well, I know that 40 years ago I shook a pastor's hand and I came forward and I filled out a card, and so therefore, you know, or I was raised in a Christian home. But inviting Jesus into your life one time many, many years ago does not, now I want to be careful how I say that, doesn't necessarily mean that you are on your way to glory. I went to a funeral once. I actually sang in this funeral, and it was many years ago. Well, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, however years ago it was. And the pastor was up there speaking. He did a great job. He spoke very well. But one of the things he said, he goes, well, the man who died, he was an old man and he died. And he said, well, 40 years ago, he filled out a card that said that he was joining the church and he had confessed that Jesus Christ, you know, he'd accepted him. Now, I didn't know him real well, but I knew him enough to know that he had not darkened the door of a church in 30 or 40 years. He, as far as I know, did not read the word. As far as I know, he didn't seem to exhibit any of the fruits that you would normally see in somebody who's really consistent with Christ. Now, I'm not saying where he is or isn't. I'm just saying there was no fruit there. And sometimes you see that and you might ponder, am I really a Christian or am I a counterfeit? Have I been born again? Am I really a child of God?
Perfect song for this morning, by the way. It's almost as if I'd called you and asked you to sing it. Am I really his child, or am I only putting up a front? Jesus gives a shockingly sobering warning in the Sermon on the Mount. The great Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 5, 6, and 7. I've attempted to memorize it, those before, and I've come semi-close, and then I kind of forget about it, and then I go back to it. But someday, when I grow up, I'm going to memorize it all. But here's what it says. Jesus says in chapter 7, verses 21 through 23, sobering, he says, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. On that day, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? Cast out devils in your name, do all kinds of mighty works in your name, and then I'm going to declare to them, never knew you. Depart from me, you workers of lawlessness. See, they thought they were right with God merely because of the great works they were performing. They forgot about actually spending time with the Lord. They forgot about finding out what he really wanted them to do. See, they thought that, like some people now think, that, well, I'm going to heaven because I go to church. I'm going to heaven because I was raised in a Christian home. I'm going to heaven because I teach Sunday school or I watch kids in the nursery. I'm going to heaven because I'm a pastor. I'm going to heaven because I lead worship, because I play the bongos, congos. And, you know, that's why I'm going to heaven, because I serve there. I do that. That's why I'm going to heaven. I'm performing, I'm doing the work, I'm praying for people. Those are all good things, by the way. They're all really good things. But if you think, as apparently these ones Jesus was talking about thought, that just doing the works alone got you right with the Lord, it's not true. You see, you cannot perform your way into heaven. It's not your performance, it's his. A Christian is not simply one who goes to a Christian church or lives in America or whatever. That reminds me, years ago, I was a construction worker, and I was among the world's worst at that profession. I really was. I was awful. And I was hired. They called me a greenhorn, and I was really green. I mean, I was as green as any kind of grass you could ever see. And I'll never forget my first day at work. I was really terrified because I knew, you know, Sergeant Schultz. I know nothing. That's really how I was. And I was really, you know, you get the tense feeling because you know you're inept going in, and that's not a good feeling. And so they hire me. Well, Tilden, get over there and help that guy over there. Oh, yes, sir. Okay. I'm on my way over there, and he's down in this hole underneath this where we were at the mill. And we're supposed to take apart all these paper machines and put in new ones. And so he was down there dismantling something, and he obviously knew what he was doing. He looked the part, and he was down there, and I was on the top, and I had three tools beside me, and my job was to hand him whatever tool he needed. Before me stood, and I know what they are now, a crescent wrench, a pipe wrench, and a spud wrench. And he's down in the hole and looks up. Hey, partner, would you hand me the crescent wrench, all right? Sure. I thought I got a 33% shot. Here you go, buddy. No, a crescent wrench. Oh, a crescent wrench. I got 50%. I picked the wrong one. He peeked his head through the hole. Do you mean to tell me you don't know what a crescent wrench is? Well, it's so hard to hear in this noisy mill. And as I was working there, they assigned me the toolbox shed now, because I didn't know any tools, so I figured the only way for me to learn how to, you know, what tools are is for me to work in the tool shed. So I'm there and I'm working with an old salty guy who'd been there forever. He knew everything and, you know, and it was all right. And he and I would get in conversations. Well, he would just talk to me mostly and I'd listen and mumble. That's a good point. Yeah. Well, one time one of his friends came into the tool shed and he said, hey, man, what are you doing? And all that talk. And then finally one of them says, I'll see you in hell. I'll see you there. They're staying like that. And under my breath, I said, you're not going to see me in hell. And I just kept doing whatever I was doing with the tools. And he stopped for a minute. One of the first times he was quiet. What do you mean by that? He said, I'm not going to hell. I'm going to heaven. He looked at me and he said, hell, ain't we all? I said, no. See, he thought he was a Christian because he lived in America. He thought he was a Christian because he'd been to church a few times. See, adhering to a certain moral standard in your life, or even that you've read portions of the Bible or whatever, or it doesn't make you a Christian. A Christian is somebody. Here's what a Christian is. A Christian is somebody in whom Christ dwells. That's what a Christian is. It's that simple. And the person in whom Christ dwells will eventually show some evidence of the fact. Maybe not right away, but some things will probably begin to change right away. And a good witness can be really good evidence. Having a good lawyer helps too. I heard the true story, and this true story about an accused man, okay, who decided to defend himself in his own case. This is what got him into trouble. He looked at the victim and he said, did you get a good look at my face when I took your purse? He went to jail. See, he could have used a good lawyer who could have spoke in his place. You and I, we have a great defense lawyer. See, you don't want to go to court, any court, especially the heavenly court, without a good lawyer, without an attorney. You're going to lose the case. Because we can't speak the legalese, proper language of heaven. You know, you go into a courtroom and these guys are, I don't even know. I mean, I wish I could have a good Perry Mason line or a Matlock line to throw. I don't know. I mean, they know all this junk. You know, the common guy, I don't know, you know. And that's how it is. Can you imagine standing before the Father? Jesus steps up as there's the prosecuting attorney, the devil's, you know, laying all these reasons why we've blown it. And Jesus steps up and I took care of it. I took care of it. I paid for him. Not guilty. If you don't have a good attorney, though, guilty as charged. See, you need somebody to defend you who can actually speak the language of heaven. One who has paid the entire penalty that heaven, our heavenly Father, has required. Speaking of a courtroom, what is the evidence that you are in fact a Christian? Do you pass the test? Is Jesus in you? Now, my goal this morning is to bring you blessed assurance. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. I want you to walk away with blessed assurance. Is it possible to have that? I think it is. There are three evidences, three witnesses that reveal you were born again. The first of them, over these next 10 minutes, is this. It's the witness of the Holy Spirit. In Luke 3:23, it says, when Jesus had been baptized, Jesus came up immediately from the water, and behold, the heavens were open to him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and alighting upon him. Now, Jesus needed the Holy Spirit. If he did, how much more do you and I do? Hello. The dove is often a symbol of the Holy Spirit in Scripture. The dove is one of two birds mentioned in the story of Noah's flood. There was the raven, there was the dove, and you remember the dove got sent out, and finally the dove came back with an olive leaf. Now the olive leaf is the universal symbol of peace. when you are walking with the Lord, when the Holy Spirit is in you, one of the evidences that he's there is that he will grant you strangely peace in the middle of the storm. It's a sign that he's there. The dove is white in color. It's a picture of purity, and the Lord will begin working on purity. Now, he declares you clean when you ask him into your life. He declares you righteous then. Your spirit is totally pure, clean, and all that. But then he works on sanctifying you and bringing your soul into alignment with your spirit. And he begins working on purity. He's going to bring conviction, never condemnation. The Holy Spirit will never condemn you, ever. That's what Satan does. Condemnation, what devil does, is he reminds you of your past failures. It's like a guy that sticks their dog's nose in the poop or whatever. Don't ever do that again, you know. And that's what the devil does, only he keeps rubbing your face in something that's happened and you've long ago asked forgiveness and he still reminds you of it. Holy Spirit doesn't do that. Holy Spirit brings conviction. Conviction is you'll know exactly what you did wrong and how to fix it. That's what conviction is. You stole money from that guy, $50. I want you to put it back and tell him you're sorry. That's conviction. The dove is gentle. And by the way, doves never retaliate against their enemies, ever. Of course, Jesus tells us to love our enemies and pray for those who persecute us. Only the Holy Spirit will give us the power to do that. And evidence that you are a Christian is that the Holy Spirit will begin to show fruit in your life. It's interesting because the wings of a dove have 9 feathers on each wing. There's 9 fruits of the Spirit. There's 9 gifts of the Spirit. It's a picture of what the Lord has made available to you and I today. A dove expresses its affection to the young by cooing in a soft tone. The Holy Spirit whispers in a still, small voice. And Jesus said, "My sheep can hear my voice." And the Holy Spirit whispers in our ear what Jesus has been saying. And Jesus heard what the Father says. If you've read in John, you see that Jesus says what the Father tells him to say. He'll say, "Oh, truly, truly." And then he'll say something because he just heard it from the Father. And then the Holy Spirit is there to finalize the deal. It says in Romans, "The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children." That's one way you can know you're saved. There's an inner testimony, a feeling, a sense produced within you by the Spirit of God who dwells in you that you are a part of the family of God. The second thing is the witness of the Word. Jesus was talking and to the Pharisees and religious leaders of the day, and he said this. He said, "You search the Scriptures because you think that in them you have eternal life." That basically he's telling, listen, you think just because you study this, that's all you got to do. But I'm telling you something. It is they that bear witness of me. Peter says, "Like newborn babies, crave pure spiritual milk so that by it you may grow up in your salvation." One of the marks of born-again believers is they get a hunger for the Word. Some of you have lost that hunger. Ask Jesus to give it back to you. You know, just ask him. Just, "Lord, would you," and just start reading just a little bit. Just start nibbling again. Ask him to start feeding that fire again. Seek him. There's only one thing that's going to stand the test of time. An interesting story about a Mississippi university, Christian university in Hattiesburg. It suffered extensive damage, but thankfully nobody was killed. 30 buildings on campus were damaged. 100 vehicles were totaled, but something amazing happened. The president said this: "We had extensive damage to our beautiful chapel on campus, but the Bible on the pulpit was left undisturbed. And it's open to Psalm 46. God is our refuge and strength in times of trouble." And in the middle of the devastation, a campus statue of Jesus also survived, surrounded by debris. See, the Word passed the test. It stood up to the storms of life and the difficulties brought by it. If you're born again, you will desire getting the Word inside of you. That's just what you will. In fact, James puts it this way, the half-brother of Jesus, in chapter 1, 22 and 23, 21, 22, he says this: "Therefore, put away all filthiness and rampant wickedness, and receive with meekness the implanted word which is able to save your souls. Don't be hearers, but actually do it. The word receive, according to the Webster's Dictionary, means this. You know, when you receive the Lord, when you receive Jesus, what you're really saying is this. It means to accept as authoritative, true, or accurate. In other words, you're the boss. When I receive the word, I say it's absolutely the truth. When I receive Jesus, he's my authority. He's my boss. And then you receive it with meekness. That is having a quiet nature, not wanting to fight or argue against. See, some people come to the word and they'll say, well, you know, there's certain parts of the Bible that are all right, but there's some parts that I just don't agree with, you know. I mean, it's just not for today. I mean, whatever it is. And so they scratch out big parts of it. I don't like that part. That, because I want to live the life the way I want to. I want to do whatever the culture says for me to do. And certain churches and denominations are falling that way too. If you're really a follower of Jesus, that means you receive with meekness. In other words, you're not arguing against this thing. What it says, you align with it. The implanted word. The word implanted means to fix or set securely. The Lord has set Jesus in you securely. He's fixed it there. You're to receive it. What are you to receive? Remember, you're talking about Jesus and you're talking about as the Word and you're talking about the Word. It says this, in the beginning was the Word and the Word was with God. The Word was God, but to all who receive him, that is, accept him as your new authority, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. I am a child of God. And the last witness is that there's an inner change going on. There's an inner change, there's an outer change. You know, something starts to happen. You know you're a believer in Christ when you want to do things that please him. You just do. You serve others in part because you want to serve others, but the other part is, I want to make Jesus smile. I want to please him. I want to treat my wife great, not only because it benefits me when I do, and how many husbands have figured that out? You treat your wife right, it's amazing how wonderful marriage can be. But you treat it for that, and you also treat her well because it makes God smile when you do. And if you really love your wife, you'll even let her handle the remote from time to time. Big responsibility, I think it is, to let her have the calm. And so, I didn't say that. But you're going to sacrifice your time and your talents to do things that bring Jesus pleasure because you want to. Suddenly, there's an inner change. I want to please the Lord. And, oh, by the way, you're also going to be willing to now stop doing the things that don't please him. He says, hey, don't do that. I don't want you to do that. But I want to. I know you do. But I don't want you to. All right, because you said it. All right, I want to please you rather than please this all the time. It doesn't matter what your friends think, what Oprah thinks, what Ashley Judd thinks, what Chris Matthews thinks, or anybody else for that matter. You care first and foremost about what Jesus thinks. That said, we all fall short. We've all missed it. We've all broken the law. And we got to remember that the law is powerless to save us. The law's purpose is to reveal sin, not to remove it. We haven't arrived. You guys haven't arrived. Now, I have, so I'm different. I'm above you all. I don't think so. Yeah, it's because I'm on the stage. You figured it out, did you? Thanks for stealing my joke. But anyway, moving on. I have not arrived. Jesus has a lot more to do in me. And by the way, the Bible in the Old and New Testament say that God's ways are past finding out. How of you know that something might look impossible, incredibly difficult, but God really does have a plan and he really has figured out how to save you and how to make things better? Anybody believe that in here? God's bigger than your problem. He's bigger than your obstacle. He's not going to remove them a lot of the time. He's just going to help you manage it. If you're really born again, you're still seeking Jesus. You still know that he's there. You're still forgiving. You're still asking for forgiveness. God still has the right to chip on you, change you. He's still chipping on me. There's a guy that really caused me a lot of pain. I won't go into any detail, but I'm just telling you that I go by his house, and every time I go by his house, I just bless him, Lord, bless him, bless him, just bless him, bless him, bless that man. And you know, it's amazing. The Lord has changed me. He's also changing him for the better. So I believe I'm going to be a better man in 5 years than I am now. I hope so. I believe I'm a better man than I was 5 years ago. Not perfect, haven't arrived, but God is still working on me. There's an inner change, there's an outer change. Moldable, teachable, changeable. Keep running the race. I want to end with these verses from Romans as Paul's writing. Because of all have fallen short. I just want to read these beginning in verse 21 of Romans chapter 7. Paul's writing, because inside of all of us, sometimes you might think, man, how can I be a Christian and have some of the horrible thoughts in my mind? How can I be a Christian and still wrestle with these evil things? How come it just everything doesn't happen easily now that I'm a Christian? I want you to know that wrestling with things and that your thought life and difficulties, that's probably a sign that you are a believer, because there's a wrestling match going on. And Paul himself was confused by the whole thing, and this is what he wrote. So I find it to be a law then, when I want to do right, evil lies close at hand. For I delight in the law of God in my inner being, but I see in my members another law waging war against the law of my mind and making me a captive to the law of sin that dwells in my members. Wretched man that I am, Paul writes. Who's going to deliver me from this body of death? Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then I myself serve the law of God with my mind, but with my flesh I serve the law of sin. And then the home run ball, maybe of the New Testament. This is what he says. There is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. He just got through talking about the wrestling match that happens all the time. The fight that's in his head, and the fact that he has a tendency in his flesh to still want to sin. But he says, there is therefore no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Do you know that you're in Christ Jesus today? Not because of your performance, not because you've been a good little boy or a good little girl, not because you go to church, not because you do this and that, but because Jesus is your lawyer. He's paid the price. You have the witness of the Holy Spirit in your life. There's giftings that he's wanting to give you. There's fruits of the Spirit, peace, patience, gentleness, self-control. Those increasing in your life. That's a sign. That's a test. The simple test is, can you confess with your mouth Jesus is your Lord, your authoritative boss? If so, I would say based on the scripture, you're in good shape. If you're not sure, examine yourself. Don't get introspective. Just believe and then move on. Yes, I am saved. Yes, I'm going to put on the helmet of salvation. I know I'm saved. Thank you, Jesus. You've implanted the word deep inside of me. I'm all right. I'm going to put on the breastplate of righteousness. Jesus, help me to walk in faith with the sword of the Spirit today, praying and seeking your face and confessing it when I blow it. I hope you have blessed assurance. Because of the finished work that Jesus did on the cross. Not because you're so dang good and so dang pretty. Though you are. Lord Jesus, thanks for loving us. Thanks for dying for us. Thanks for being our advocate. Thanks for sending the Holy Spirit to live inside of us as a down payment. Thank you for just caring for us. And thank you for the blessed assurance that Jesus is mine. not because of my performance, but because of your performance, Jesus. We receive you. We believe you. Keep working on this old mind and heart and flesh of mine. But I'm yours. And I confess, even as the song said that we sang with, I am a child of God. I am a child of God. Thank you, Jesus, that you removed the stink and you made me right with the Father. You're so good. Amen. Bless you guys today. Have a good day. This is one right here.